So I was saying that whenever we calculate, we'll calculate on the value of the input size, and that is so. And that what is that? The running time is the number of CPU cycles it will take to finish this, like running time of this algorithm. And how we calculate this is mostly the loops. Most of the time, it's the number of loops or number of times it will repeat something. That is what the count we have to find. The count of the loop, how many times the loop will go. Now comes the other part is worst case. Okay, the number of loops it will go, or the number of times CPU cycle it will take, the amount of time it will take to find a solution in the worst case. Because suppose I ask you to find the maximum in an, are you there? Everyone here? Because I think I'm disconnected about.
Yeah, I'm able to hear.
So as I was saying, the number of CPU cycles, and we have to calculate that. Let me just tell you a simple question is find maximum in an array, maximum element. So again, for the first thing is, what is the input here? Input is an array of numbers. Okay. Sorry. So input is an array of numbers, and input size we are assuming is an n size array. So how do we find the maximum? One solution, one way to find the maximum is keep a current maximum in your variable, current max, and that will be like, okay, first element is a, assume first element is current max, and then I'll keep on comparing with every other element one by one. So my loop will be for I equal to 0, I less than n, and I plus plus. Okay. And for in every loop, current max will change. Okay. I'm not writing code. If you want, I can write code, but I'm just trying to tell you this code. Some there will be some code which will be executed here. Some code. Some code we'll have here inside this loop, and this loop will run n times. Okay, this loop will run n times. So for each element, we'll do something. So this is the number of CPU cycles we have to count. And very simple. This is a very simple case I've told. So this most times you'll be able to find your number of loops easily by just looking at the code. Sometimes you might not able to see this clearly, but you have to think. And let's take another case now. Let's solve a question. Okay, let's solve a question. Fibonacci. You all have heard of Fibonacci. Okay, Fibonacci series.
Yes.
What is that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So question is for all of you. We'll try to solve this. We'll try to find the time complexity. We'll try to see how to count the number of loops here. Okay. So and also we'll talk about a few more things in single question. This question contains a lot of information. So Fibonacci of n we have to find. That's the question. You can start solving. Forget about the time complexity. Just try to solve right now. And if someone has any problem, and no, if doesn't know what is Fibonacci is, ask me the question. Rest of you can start solving, and try to write a code instead of if you know what the solution is. Okay, write some simple code, and then read that code to me when you're done. You all have laptop with you or a pen paper with you?
Yes.
Yeah. So try to write a code, and then once you have done with the writing, just read that to me.
Praveen, could you just repeat the question like related to Fibonacci?
Yeah. So given a so the question is find the so Fibonacci in the Fibonacci series, like Fibonacci of 1 is equal to this index 1, 2, 3, 4. So find the Fibonacci of n. What is Fib of n? So for
Oh,
example,
okay.
okay, what is the
Yeah.
value?
Praveen, sorry, I did not get that.
So question is find Fibonacci of n. You have to solve this. That's the question. And if you do not know Fibonacci, ask me. Otherwise, just try to write a code for finding Fibonacci.
Got it.
Anyone?
Praveen, we can do this in two approaches. The first one is iterative and the second one is recursive.
Okay, awesome. You're using fancy terms and we'll also iterative solution and the recursive solution. Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay.
In iterative, we can take three integer variables like F1 and F2.
F1 is equal to 1 and F2 equal to 2. How much?
No. Yeah, F equal to 0, F1 equal to 0, F2 equal to 1.
F1 equal to 0 and F2 equal to 1.
Yeah. So now we can write a loop.
Mm-hmm.
We can add F1 and F2 into F.
Okay.
Then we can add the F value into the F2.
Mm-hmm.
Then we can add F2 value into F1. So we can return that value at the final. We can get the Fibonacci of the whatever the value given by the input.
Okay.
And recursive is we can just write a recursive loop.
Mm-hmm.
Where we can fib of n-1 plus n-2. Just return that value and we can get that value. But I think it would take more time than iterative. But not sure.
Okay. So everyone following this, what I'm writing?
Yes.
Okay. This is just speak yourself. Okay. I won't be asking every time. Please speak. You just speak yourself. It's not getting anything. Okay. Stop me somewhere, anywhere you want. So the recursive solution we have written and iterative we are writing. F of some new f is equals to f of 1 plus f of f2, and then we have our this thing. Something like this, and at the end when we are done with the loop, just return something like this. It might not be the replicate, but this is what he was trying to say.
Yeah.
Okay. And the recursive was just calculate this. Okay. So in this ITT approach, everyone can see here, this is very easy to find. We are running a loop n times, and where n is what? N is the input. Again, input might not be input size, but it's like the input variable which we have to find for. Like our time complexity will vary upon the value of n. So we have to find the complexity in terms of n only here. Okay. So our time complexity will be n times. Okay. Our loop will run n times here. The CPU cycles, n CPU cycles. So our time complexity will be something of n. Okay. Sorry. So it will be some function of n. It will be, by the way, it will be exactly equal to n. The function is n only. So, and how do we write it now? Now comes the the standard way to talk about is we talk in terms of big O of n, big O. We use the term big O of n. Okay. We will not call it function of n, we'll just call it big O of n. So it will take n CPU cycles, and hence the time complexity would be big O of n, order of n. That's it. Very simple loops. We can easily see. We know this thing will run for n times. If n is 10, it will run 10 times. If n is 100, it will run 100 times. So this is order of n time complexity. Now if we see the recursive approach, okay? Identity was very simple to find. Now come, can you tell me how many times this loop will run? How many CPU cycles does it need to solve this problem? And clearly this is a little bit difficult. You can't see the loop easily, but we know this will have a loop. This will, if not straightforward, there is a loop somewhere happening, or there is, if not loop, there is some lots of CPU cycles are going to calculate the Fibonacci of n. So
is that n square?
N square. N square. Who told?
Nikhil.
Okay, great. You're saying n square. Everyone, do you think this is correct?
No, Praveen. It takes n.
What?
N.
N. Okay. One is n square. Okay. One of you saying is n square, and one of you saying n. Anyone else? Anything else?
I think it's more than n square.
It will be exponential form.
Exponential. Okay.
Yeah, correct.
Okay. Correct. So something exponential of n. So people, you are still correct here. So it is not n. It is not n square. It is some exponential of n. Let's try to think. How does so? You got this. You have to find how many times the loop will run. So you see, now you know what to find. Okay. Now you know what to find in terms of what. Now comes another capability of another skill of finding exactly how. So we can see here. Let's try to. If not able to think, let's. What you do is normally try to execute this solution for some basic questions. Suppose for n equal to 2, n equal to 3, n equal to 10. How much? You just try to solve calculate time for these small values and then try to generalize. Okay. So let's try to solve this Fibonacci of n using recursive, using this method. Let's complete this method. Can someone complete this? Will this work? We'll have to complete this. It's not complete.
If n is less than 1, return n. Otherwise, return the n minus 1, n minus 2.
Yeah. So now comes the little bit knowledge of recursion. Okay. How to write recursion? Sometimes recursion feels one of the easiest way to implement. Sometimes it feels tough also. Okay. There will be cases when you will find a recursion code easier, and there will be sometimes when you will find writing a iterative code easier. Okay, so there is some tricks of not tricks. The simple logic of recursion is you use the same method to calculate its same method value, something like that. You use the same method itself. Okay, that's what recursion is. Now, whenever you do a recursion, we should always be aware of base cases. Okay, before we write our, we know we should be aware of the base case. What is the base case? What is the terminating case? Okay, what is the terminating condition of this recursion? There should be something. Otherwise, we keep on going forever. Okay. So there should be some terminating condition. There should be some base case. So base case here is if n equal to 0, if n equal to 0, then return something 1, suppose. Okay. So we know Fibonacci of 1, 0, we know it will be 1. So let it be 1. Now this has a terminating condition for anything more than n, it will keep on calling itself. Okay. So we have a terminating condition. Along with that, we have the actual recursion which we have written. Okay. So now we have written our Fibonacci of n methods recursively, and hopefully this is good enough. Now how will we calculate? Let's try to calculate this for n equal to 3. So when we call our fib of 3, This will call okay, when we call it for 3, this will call it for fib of 2, and then this will call for fib of 1. Okay, now this fib of 2 will call for fib of fib of 1 and fib of 0. And this fib of 1, we'll call it for, let's make the code even correct, less than equal to 0. And this fib of 1, we'll call it for fib of 0, and this will call it for fib of minus 1. Now these two will terminate here. Okay, we won't go deeper here, but in this case fib of 1 will still go deeper, and this will do the same thing once again. Okay, so how many times did we do this? So for fib of 2 we started it here. So it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So for 3, we did it 8 times. Okay? Okay? So what we see for 3, 8 times. Thoda idea change lag gaya. Okay. For 3, it is 8 times. This means 2 to the power 3. 8. Yeah, I think this is something like 2 to the power something. So for me, I can easily say this is 2 to the power n. If you can calculate, how did we calculate? It's like for okay, so for me, this is n. Now, time for n is equal to time for n minus 1 plus time for n minus 2. If you know these two values, 1 plus this. Okay, this is. I mean, I'm trying to now write a formula, but most of the cases you won't have to write this formula. You can easily see and tell the number of loops, but I'm trying to solve for you using a formula as well. So if you want to calculate T of n, there was so time to solve for n will be equal to 1 plus time for n minus 1 and time for n minus 2. Is it correct? This line is correct for everyone?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So, and by maths, this will come to 2 of 2 to the power n. And there is one standard, I don't remember the formula right now. This was to find a time for n. Right. I'll tell you the formula sometime later. But we don't, why I'm not remembering it, because I don't use that formula ever. Like there is a formula also, sometimes that formula works and sometimes it doesn't. But I don't remember that because I don't use that. This is normally we are able to find the running time or the time complexity without, just by analyzing this. Just we can easily see. Sometimes we can use the formula as well. I'll tell you the formula later. Okay. So this value, this t of n equal to 1 plus t of n minus 1 plus t of 2 n minus 2. This will tell you that t of n is 2 of 2 to the power n. Okay. 2 to the power n. So this is one of the worst time complexity ever. Like we will never be looking for to solve a problem in time complexity of exponential case. Okay, matlab this is the worst we will ever try, and hence our better solution would be go for iterative approach, and that's how we can solve this. Okay, now can you, by the way, everyone got this recursive and iterative approach, and everyone got the time complexity of iterative approach, time complexity of recursive approach. And also everyone got the how to write recursion. Mostly while writing recursion, you always have to think about base case. First of all, just try to list all the base cases. If this is this, then return this. If this this, then return this. Once you're done with the base cases, then you write the your recursion simple. The method of n will be equal to method of n minus 1 or something like n minus n by 2, something like that. Okay. So that's how we write recursion. That's how we write recursive methods. Okay. So, and we know by calculating the time complexity, we came up with that the complexity will be 2 to the power n. Okay, for n, it will be 2 to the power n time complexity. So, my question is now, can you do it better using recursion only? You have to use recursion. I mean, sorry, not I'm not saying use recursion. I'm just saying you can't use the iterative method without iterative method. Okay. Yeah, so the question is, find the Fibonacci of n without iteration. Why I'm asking this is I'll try to include one more topic, just giving a taste. We'll do that a lot later. So in this by solving the solving this is special case. So find the Fibonacci of n without iteration. And of course, better than 2 to the power n. I mean, we already have solved it without iteration, but that complexity was 2 to the power n. We want to solve it without iteration, but with a better time complexity.
But do you use recursive or any other method?
I mean, we can't use iteration. We can use anything else, which obviously means you do recursion. But yeah. I'm going to give you flavor of dynamic programming a little bit here. So try to think a little bit. And how did I, so this is a question you people ask, how to think interviews, which algorithm to use. And this is one point where I'll tell you, okay, well, how did I come up with, why should I use the dynamic programming or not? So I'll tell you.
Hey, Praveen, yeah, Nikhil.
Yes, Nikhil.
Yeah, we can store it in an array. So what we can do is, first number will be the first element of the array, that is 0, then second number will be 1. And then we can declare a for loop, and in that for loop return the other ith element recursively from 1 to n.
Yeah, I mean, you are close, but why to just say we'll use for loop? We'll not do any for loop, that's it. I mean, we'll use it now. Okay, so his point is he'll use extra space. Okay, so he will use extra space, which should be okay with the interviewer. And I'm saying, yeah, it's okay to use extra space. Now tell, so he's using extra space. We can solve this Fibonacci of n without iteration.
Yeah. Then I am having one solution here.
Uh-huh.
Instead of directly returning your fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2,
uh-huh,
we can store that value into some kind of any variable, and while calculating fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2, we can check that value in the array position whether it's available or not.
Okay.
If it's available, then we can return that value itself instead of recursive.
Yes. So what you're trying to say is we'll use the recursion, and instead of just calculating it every time, just store somewhere. Okay. So yeah. Everyone, I think you must have got the hint what I was trying to ask you. And you people have, as I told you, we'll use dynamic programming and all. So this is where the logic of dynamic programming comes. So what happens, that the dynamic program is, you can solve that problem by recursion, but the recursion takes a lot of time. So why not store that value somewhere? Instead of calculating it every time, why not store the value somewhere while solving, and you can use the stored value for our other sub problems. Okay, what we do in recursion, what we do is we solve the method by calling the sub problem, by dividing the problem into sub problem, and then calling the our recursively, that those sub problems. So in the little trick here is to store the values, and that's what dynamic programming is. Okay, the recursion, same recursion, if you store the value, that helps you reduce the time a lot, because you don't have to rerun the same method, because you already have that method called once. So why to call it twice? So if you see our fib of 3, we called in a fib 2 and fib 1, and then fib 2 called again for fib 1 and fib 0. This fib 1 was getting called twice. Okay, Fibonacci of 1 was getting called twice. So let's, instead of doing it twice, let's store it somewhere. So let me just now write what I'm trying to say is, let's just write it. So initialize an array, some fib array, okay, equal to our, okay, we have initialized this, and now to calculate fib of n, what you do is, this is equal to fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2 with the base condition, with some base condition. If, okay, let me not write, call it fib, let's call it A. If A of n is not equal to 0, okay, then only go ahead and calculate. Otherwise just return whatever is in that okay, do you see this? So what I'm saying is, don't calculate. If it is already calculated, just return. So what will happen is, we have, by doing this, we are not calling our fib of one twice. Once the fib of one was calculated, it would have stored the values of in our A, and we won't go deeper in that loop. So we, with this approach, what will the time complexity be? First of all, everyone got the solution, got the trick here, and got what is dynamic program a little bit. We'll talk about again in detail. We'll solve more questions dynamic program. This is one of the very favorite question for people in interviews. Like they really want to ask dynamic programming, because that is something trickier to think on the spot, but people like to ask these kind of questions. And this is the trick mostly. The trick is find the recursive solution at least once easily. Once you found the recursive solution, try to think how can I store the where can I store the values.
What Praveen, most, Nikhil, yeah. Can you yeah. Can you explain your solution with an example? Taking yes. Fib of 3.
Yeah. So fib of 3, we're trying to calculate fib of 3. And then what we'll do is, fib of 3 will check, is the value 0? Yes, it's 0. So let's try to calculate fib of 2 and fib of 1. Okay, fib of minus n minus 1 and n minus 2. So when you calculate for fib of 1 and fib of 2, so let's have fib of 2. Let's go up only. Yeah, this one. So by when I called fib of 3, it called in fib of 2 and fib of 1. So when I again in recursively, when fib of 1 called fib of 0 and fib of minus 1, and with all those old base conditions, we have stored the value in fib of 0. This will become this will terminate. We haven't written there. I'm storing as well. So every time I calculate, this is just stored, and at the end we will return is a of n. Yeah. So when I called a of 0 and a of minus 1, sorry, fib of 0 and fib of minus 1, I stored some value at 0th index. Okay, I stored some. This is the first time the deepest loop, the deepest method, the fib of 0, which was called for the first time, this ended up storing some value at 0th index. Do you get, okay? Till when we started, it didn't store. The first time it stored value was here, because this was the base, some term. Let me again, then we'll have to write more terminated condition, which we wrote here. If this one, if this is a of n is not equal to 0, then go ahead and calculate. So one more base conditions will be, if n is less than equal to 0, I mean, we could have initialized only with, because we could have initialized only easily properly, but since let's suppose we're not initializing, yeah. Okay. So what I'm saying is, while so for the first time, which is the first time when I entered something in my array, when I called fib of 0, okay, or fib of minus 1, like forget of minus 1, we won't even reach there, minus 1. But fib of 0 will end up storing, converting this to something like 1, okay. Now, fib of minus 1, you know, we won't go there, we'll handle those edge cases as well. I'm trying to just tell the basic algorithm. We'll try to handle edge case later. So by the first time I called this, this one ended up storing one here. Now this fib of 0, can you see this? This will be called again. and this point of time, it won't go deeper. It will just see, okay, this value is not zero. This means that that is the value we want to store there, okay? So we won't go deeper. We'll just use the array in there. Now coming to fib of one. Fib of one will see what is fib of zero and what is fib of minus. And since these two things are, we won't go deeper, fib of one will also be calculated easily without going deeper in fib of zero and fib of minus one. And now using this fib of one, and this will for the first time, this will be called for the first time, this will end up storing, and this will just see, okay, we have already calculated, so this also won't go deeper. Okay, this all will take one time, and at the end we have our fib of two. Okay. I think fib of one is one only. We assume fib of one is one. So, okay, our base cases are not good. If you want, we can write base cases properly. What I'm saying is, by every time we are calling recursion, we are changing our this array one by one. And by doing this, we are changing our this array. We are storing the correct value. And next time when we are going to calculate this, we see, okay, we are calculating fib of two. Fib of one is already there. Fib of zero is already there. So my fib of 2 will be fib of 0 plus fib of 1. So at the end, we have our fib of 3. Okay. Nikhil, did you get?
Yeah.
If you want, I can write a little bit clean code, but I'm talking about Sudoku. If you want, you can try to implement. I'll go through your code later, or I'll write a code, clean code, I'll send you later, okay? But this is what Sudoku we are trying to write. When we write our proper code, we should be writing proper edge cases. We should be handling all the edge cases as well. Okay, I do not do this right now. But whenever you go for interview, this is once you have written the working solution, you should be able to handle all the edge cases, base cases, failing cases. All like that's what you have to handle. It's not that I'm skipping it. You will be skipping it. You have to make sure that you are always thinking about this. Okay, so try to code when we are done with the classes so that you are able to handle edge cases. Mostly when we write the code, that is the point of time when we like feel like we have to do it. We can't skip. Okay. So try to handle edge cases every time.
Okay. Praveen, Vasant here. Can you hold on a minute? Can you hear me?
Yeah,
the question is we need to print what is the Fibonacci number of nth term. For example, if I give 9, means what is the value, what is the Fibonacci value for the 9? Term 9, that's correct, right?
Yes.
Okay. In this logic, whatever you write it on, right? I think we need to modify a little bit. I think otherwise, if you see, if a of n not equal to 0, if it is not equal to 0, then at any case, the inside if condition is not going to execute. Can you see that one?
Yeah. Which condition? If a is not... So what I want to write is, if it is not already calculated, okay, something I want to write. If not calculated, so this can be a of n not equal to 0, or suppose I initialized with everything was minus 1, suppose. Okay, the base value I initialized, I didn't know what to, so what I'll do is initialize with this. In this case, we'll check if a of n is equal to, if this is equal to minus 1 or not equal to minus 1, then only try to calculate. Otherwise, leave it. Don't try to calculate. This is already calculated.
Okay, then I'll say of n. Okay, sure.
So this is what the condition I'm checking is, don't try go deeper. It is already calculated. You just skip it. Okay, that's what it means.
Okay, what is the else condition if it is... if it is not calculated, if it is calculated, then just we need to return a of n, right?
Yeah, that you can think is. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
See. You can go deeper, but let me write the perfect solution for you. but try to understand the solution here. No, let's not go exact code. I haven't written a working code here. I'm just trying to write the gist. If you want, I can write the proper working code. You want to go ahead? Everyone want to take a 5 minutes? We can try to write the most working code. Salai?
Now it makes sense. It depends upon your quantity.
Okay. Even if it doesn't, you should be aware how to solve. And if you want, I can go ahead and write a proper working code. It won't take more than 5 minutes. We can go ahead. But I won't spend any time here. Okay. Let's talk something more important. But I would say, yeah.
I think the working code written by us would be the good, I think. So working code writing,
we
helpful.
We cannot spend a lot of time here. But I would suggest everyone go through, and I'll give you again, the way I do it is, I share my number and you can ping me on WhatsApp, and I would reply with the solution, like whatever doubt you have. Okay. During the 24/7, you can like ping me. I might be busy, but I'll reply you sometime for sure. So try to, if you have time, try to keep on writing code, like not just theory, no more theory personally. When you're doing it on your side, just try to write code as much as code as possible, because that whatever I teach you will be of zero use if you're not writing code, because that's what you have to do, that's what you need to do in interviews. Okay, so try to write a lot of code. That too working code, and that too like bilkul handling edge cases. Okay, that's what you have to do. You just can't skip anything. Okay, so let's go ahead. Where were we? So I was talking about the time complexities, and I was talking about the iterative and recursion. Then we talked about recursion is not so efficient. Let's use some trick of storing the values. That's what dynamic programming is. We talked, and we'll solve more questions of dynamic programming. Let me give you one task. Find the standard. The first question of dynamic programming is, I guess, what is the first question of dynamic programming? Okay, I don't know the question. We'll do it later. I'll give you one dynamic programming. We'll solve one dynamic programming in the next class. I'll give you when the class ends. We'll solve that question in the next class. Now coming back, so our time complexity, we know how to calculate. We can see the loops easily. If loops are not visible easily, we should be able to read the solution, and then we should be able to count the CPU cycles it will take to solve that. And now comes the space complexity. Okay, the space complexity here, how much space do we need to solve this? How much extra space do we need to solve this? Most of the times, what we'll do is a few variables will solve the problem. But there will be so many times we will have to store the value temporarily somewhere so that we can calculate this. And in those cases, we need some extra space. And the amount of space compared to the input size only. If n, we need n space. We need a hash of size n. We need an array of size n. We need a heap of capacity n. So that's what we have to find out. How much, what kind of data structure, and how many buckets kind of we can call it. How many indexes we need to store that. And that's what the space complexity is. And with dynamic programming, can someone tell what was the space complexity with the dynamic programming to find the Fibonacci of
O of n,
order of n, big O of n. So we need an array of size n at least to find the Fibonacci of n. Okay, so this solution needed some extra space, which is okay. If you talk to me about general software development, we do not care about space a lot these days. We only worry about speed. We have lots of space these days. We don't really care about space. They just make sure that I'm just saying it on average case, not everywhere. But mostly when we try to do development in our companies, we make sure that our algorithm is the fastest, even if it's using a little bit. I mean, ideally we should be doing fastest without using extra space. But I have seen this is the trend. Most of the time we don't care about the space. We care about the time complexity. Okay, and that will be the approach in interviews as well. Most of the time, we'll care about the complexity of time complexity. We'll not be worried about space a lot, but it is always better to you keep in mind. Okay, we are using a space, and we should be mentioning ourselves. Okay, so we'll take this much of time using this much of extra space. That's how we will talk. Okay, So this problem, the Fibonacci of n using dynamic programming, it took order of n time, where n is the input you gave, and it is of order n time using an extra space of array of size n, and hence the time, space complexity would also be order of n, big O of n. Okay, good. Are you good here? Go ahead a little bit. Okay. Yeah.
So there, what is the time complexity?
Yeah, time complexity we told, na, the time complexity of this dynamic programming is order of n. So we started with two approach, iterative and recursive. Iterative was order of n, and recursive was order of 2 to power n. Now, and both of them did not use extra space. But my next part of the question was to do it using without iteration. So without iteration, it was taking 2 to the power n. We had to improve. So we said, okay, I can do it without iteration, but I'll need extra space of size n, and then I can do it in or less time. I won't need 2 to the power n. I can do it less, and that less time was n. We solved without iteration in order n. So at the end, the best solution is order n. We can't do it better than order of n. We can't do it better than that.
Then the iteration and the last one takes the same.
Yeah. Yes, iteration and last one same. But the bad thing about the last one, is we need extra space. Iteration, we don't need any extra space. Okay. I mean, we just need two constants, f1 and f2, and that would be that if you still they ask not write down, you'll say is order of one or constant. Okay. Okay. The order of one means constant time. We don't need order of one means constant or not just time. Time or space, what we say. So we don't need extra space. We just constant space, order one space. That's what it means. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Let's go ahead now a little bit. Let me go through the slides. We might not talk about everything. Just go through the slides. So this is one example. We have taken an example of sorting to teach you about the time complexity, the running time. So let's talk about this only now. So we have an input, a sequence of numbers, A1, A2, A3, we have N numbers, okay? And the output we are looking for is, so 2, 5, 4, 10, 7, the output we are looking for is 2, 5, 4, sorry, 2, 4, 5, 7, 10. This is sorted in ascending order. So tell us how we do it. That's what, first of all, solve this. Can you sort an input array? Yes, we can. What are the ways? There are multiple ways. Do we really want to how much time complexity we are looking for? We'll talk about that later. Okay, but there are multiple sorting algorithms, and the most brute force or the most simplest you can even think yourself, and there are people who have named that, like we have been giving standard name to these sorting algorithms. So let's just talk about how will you sort. Okay, I'll tell you the name which has been already given to that kind of algorithm. So 2, 5, 4, 10, 7. How will you sort an array? Forget about any standard algorithm. Just tell me, how will you sort? Sukanya. So given an array of size n, this is the input array. How will you sort? Try to tell me like loops, what loops you will run and all those things. The code, what will you write?
Praveen, is Nikhil?
Yes, Nikhil.
Yeah, so I can take that array and I can split it up into two. One from one max to another max, and the other is from n plus one to another z minus one. And then I can find the maximum in that subset array and mean the maximum in that subset array by comparing each one. Or splitting that array into separate arrays again, and comparing each one, and then finally compare both the in the end smallest array into the last smallest array of the two previous ones.
I did not follow. No, wait, Chukanya. So Nikhil, I didn't get what your solution. I didn't understand. Try, can you try again?
So the a1 to an, we can split it up into, say, a1 to some middle constant, ak.
Okay, so we have split the array into two small arrays. Have you seen that?
Yes.
Okay, after that?
After that, I can compare each element in those smaller arrays.
Compare each element with the smaller array. I didn't get it.
So I can say say I have a1 to ak in one array and ak plus 1 to an in another array. So I take a1 one sec, a1 to, okay, I can do this. I can keep dividing that A1 to AK into another, keep on dividing it into smaller arrays and compare each element of that array. So in the end, I will get just one element, right? And in the end, after I divide that array A1 to AK, I will get just one element.
Okay. Yes.
And in the other subset from AK plus 1 to AN, I will get one element.
Okay.
Correct. And then I will compare those elements.
Okay.
And similarly, I'll go upwards.
Okay. So still, I'm not sure if it will work or not, but you're making a little bit complex. We can discuss this later, but I don't think this approach is, first of all, I'm not sure if it will work or not. Even if it works, it's too much complex. Okay. So let Sukanya try.
We can try crown shot or quick shot.
Let's not use those words. Instead, let's try to tell me the solution. Like whatever, just choose anyone and tell me how will it do.
So if it is quick shot, I can then take length as R and then length as L, and then I can start from R. And when L will be less than R, I can keep on comparing the elements.
Okay, and after that?
Elements in the ith place only. I will keep on shorting them in the nth place.
So, again, you have heard about quicksort, and there's some problem with you with whatever you're trying to say. Let me start with the base, for the basic, like, base case. Suppose no one knows about these quicksort and all this. What do we do? What will do? One of those brute force, one of the most brute force approach will do is, the thing about someone who doesn't know computer science, how will he solve? How can he solve? So one of the way he can do is, he can try all the permutation of these numbers. Okay, suppose 2, 5, 4, 10, 7, he will take another array and just copy all the elements from that array to this new array, and he will try all the permutation one by one. Actually, so he will keep 2, 5, 4, 10, 7, and then he'll keep 2, 4, 5, 10, 7. And then he'll keep 2, 4, 5, 7, 10. He'll just keep on trying all the permutation one by one. And whichever one is sorted, this is the sorted one. So do you get what are the most brute force approach, the most trivial approach? Like someone who knows nothing, what will do? Sara combination try kar lega wo. Ek bar, for the first time, what will do is 2, and then he'll keep 5, 4, 10, 7, 10, 10, 2, 4, let's switch 4 and 5, or let's switch 7 and 10, let's switch 5 and 7, something. He'll try everything. So by doing that, there would be one permutation which will be sorted. Okay, this is one of the worst approach someone can take. But yeah, this will also solve. If you ask me, will this solution work? Yes, this will work, because we know if you try for all the cases, one of the case is going to be sorted. Okay, this is like your hacking password. Like you'll try all the combination of password, and some at least one password will work. So that kind of approach this is, which is bad. And because how much will the time complexity? Can someone tell me the time complexity of this approach? First of all, everyone got the approach which I said. What we are doing here to sort this input. So we have been given input of size n, and we want to sort. The worst approach I gave is try all the permutation, and one of them will be sorted and return that whichever one is sorted. So what will the time complexity be?
N factorial something.
N factorial something. Okay. Anyone else? What?
N cross, I mean N square, N cross N.
N square?
No, 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 N cross N.
What is N cross N?
I mean N to the power N. Number of elements to the power N.
Okay, N to the power N. Anyone else? Okay, so it won't be N to the power N. And just think yourself, why not? It will be some n factorial, which is correct. And this is like our school mathematics. We have n people. We have to arrange in a number of ways to arrange that. That is n factorial, okay? From number of permutation, if you remember. So number of ways to arrange these people will be n factorial. That's so the time complexity of the worst approach is n factorial. So I'm more concerned about time complexity today. Otherwise, we'll have to at least switch to the best solution. We are not talking about best solution right now. So, apart from this trivial, any other normal, like you and all of you computer scientists, so computer engineers, sorry, engineers. So, what would you do? You won't do this first approach.
Take two for loop and compare with the current element to the next element. Like assume the outer loop and inner for loop.
Okay.
In the outer for loop, I'm going to take one value. Inner for loop, what it is going to do, just take the current element and the next element, compare. Okay. If it is the current element is greater than next element, just swap it. Do the same things, over all the elements. Like for this one, we need two for loop.
Okay.
Complexity is n square.
Okay. So, Santosh, you're saying you'll do arrays.sort. Of course, we can, but that's what we are trying to find. What is internally how that sort is implemented? Okay. We are not aware. We will talk about all the sorting algorithms. One of them, but currently wasn't suggested. The name of that one is bubble sort. Okay, what he suggested, I took the name first, but let me just repeat what he said. It has a very popular name, bubble sort. Okay, so what he does is he'll just run a loop. Okay, one loop, simple loop first, and compare each element which is with its consecutive number. Okay, it will compare. Number at zeroth index and first index, and just check is it correct or not. Is the order correct? Is 2-5 order correct? Yes, correct. Don't do anything. Is 5-4 order correct? No, the order is wrong. So let's swap. It will become 2-4-5. Okay. Now let's go to next element. 5-10 is the order correct? Yes. Don't do anything. Let's go to next element. 10-7 order correct? No. Swap. Make it 10-7-10. So by doing this once, he ensured that each of the number. Is like each consecutive number is correct, placed properly. This is only one time. This won't make sure it will be sorted, but it will sort at least something out of it. Like by doing this once, we can just ensure some of the sort things are sorted properly. But what if we do n times? Okay, same thing. Let's keep on doing this n times. So for the first time, it became 2-4-5, and then 5-10. Let's do it n times. By the nth time, you'll find that this is completely sorted. Okay, so the algorithm which right now we discussed, wasn't told, is called bubble sort. Okay, one of the ways to sort. This is one of the way to sort. We'll talk about the time complexity as well. But what we are doing here is we are comparing each consecutive element every time, and then just making sure that these two are sorted. When these two are properly placed. So 2-5. As I said, I'll repeat. We started with index 0 and we did okay. A of 0 and A of 1. Compared that. Are they properly placed? Yes. Among them, yes. 2-5. So don't do anything. Let's go to the next element. 1-5-4. So are they pro? No. So let's swap them. It will become 2-4-5. Okay. Now we'll do for 5 and then 10. Is 5-10 properly placed? Yes. Don't do anything. Go ahead. We'll do it for 10-7. Is it properly placed? Yes. No. So let's swap them. 7-10. Then we reached end. By doing this, we sorted at that place only. We didn't do a lot. But somehow, actually, this is a special case where one loop only ended up solving. But let's think about some weird cases, not in general cases where one loop might not be, have been sufficient. Okay, you had to do this for multiple times. And the worst case is you'll have to do the same thing n times. In this case, we ran the loop only one time, and we felt as if the time complexity would be order of n only. But if you take the generic or the worst case, the time complexity would be different. Can someone think about the worst or generic case? Like how much? Let's talk about the worst case only. How much time do you think it'll take in the worst case? What will the time complexity of this bubble sorting? If everyone got the solution, first of all, did you get? I'll be writing a pseudocode in some time, but you can also think about the complexity, time complexity in the worst case. So let me just try to write bubble sort for you. The pseudocode, then we'll see the exact code somewhere. Or let me just find my bubble sort code. You can see my screen now. Browser. Yeah. So let's just go through the bubble sort code. I won't be spending a lot of time writing the code. So how many of you have heard this bubble sort term at least earlier?
I heard.
Okay. This is one of very popular thing which we read in our, right, so slow, in our like these kind of data structure algorithm courses. This is the first thing we read about. Okay. So this is a code for our bubble sort. What it takes an array. Okay. And it just runs loop n times. So this is external loop 0 to n minus 1. And then internal loop 0 to again n minus 1 somewhere. And what it does is swaps. Every time it compares the element with the next element and just make sure that if it is not properly placed, just make it place it properly, like swap it. Okay. And what we just did was this part. And we have to repeat this thing n times. We have to repeat this thing n times to make sure that this is sorted. For any case, this will work. But if okay, our case was a little different. So let's take this case, sorted array. Okay, so this is output.
N square in case of worst case.
Yes, correct. So everyone can see this. The worst case would be n square. Okay. Can someone? Anyone who did not know why would be n square? Is there someone meaning here?
Two loops.
I think it. Is there anyone who do not understand how it would be n square? This is very clearly visible from here. We have two loops. One loop runs 0 to n minus 1, or n minus i minus 1, an external loop runs 0 to n minus 1. So the number of time it will run is n square. And in every loop, we're not doing anything. We're just doing constant operation. So if you really want to calculate, this will be n square. Square into swap time, okay, and swap time we assume ki this is order of one, so this is n square at the end. Let me just go through this illustration again once. So we had this input. what is this input? 5319. Okay, I won't go through that. Okay, just ignore the example now. Let's just concentrate on this algorithm only, which is bubble sort. We'll just repeat this. You have to go like after the class, you have to try implement this yourself and try to see. I mean, you can try to calculate the complexity yourself, but just go through the code once again. Let's go through code once again. So what we are doing inside for, and we'll repeat this n times. We are just swapping in each and every element with this if it's not properly placed. Okay, so coming back to the slide now, one algorithm is bubble sort, which takes order of n square. Can we do it better? Can we do it in less time?
Yes.
Yeah, what was the space complexity of this bubble sort which we just saw?
O of 1,
okay, constant time.
Yeah,
not 0, constant time. We don't need extra space. Everyone, we don't need extra space, okay? So the time complexity was order of n square, which you can see from the loop. And the space complexity was constant time, no extra space, order of 1, whatever you say. No, we don't need extra space. We'll use constant space or order of 1, whatever you say, okay? So that's what the time complexity was. Now my next question is, can we improve? Can we do something better than order of n square? Santosh?
I didn't get any thought.
Okay, not a problem. So did you understand the bubble sort, by the way?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, let's try one more and then we'll catch it. Is it better or not? Let's try one more algorithm called insertion sort. Okay, that was more intuitive to me. So, but I think Vasant or someone started with bubble sort. Let's talk about the insertion sort now. Okay, you don't have to be aware of like, is it each, you don't have to implement everything, but people in interviews expect you to be aware of everything. If they ask you, you should be aware of what is insertion sort, what is bubble sort, what is quick sort and all. Okay, so you should be aware as an engineer also what are the other different types of algorithms. So now let's talk about another solution. But in that, what I'll do is I'll go through each and every element and I'll pick that element and try to insert into it correct position. I'll try to find what the correct position should be. Okay, so I'll take two. I'll pick the first element and I'll just try to insert that somewhere in my array where it suits the best. Where should it go? And what I'll do is I won't try to find it in full array. I'll just try to insert into a sorted array, already sorted part. So let's take a case. 2, 5, 4, 10, and 7. Okay. So what I'm doing is 2, 4. Suppose I ran the loop for I times. Okay. I am in the middle of the solution. By that point of time, my first part of the array will be already sorted. And then I'll have some non-sorted part. So I'll take the first.
I can't hear you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, your voice is breaking.
Okay. Still, is it still breaking? Hello. Is it still breaking?
Yes. Yeah. It breaks in the end.
Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Kind of.
Okay. Okay. What do we do?
I think someone will have to mute their mic.
You can just mute your mic if you're not using it, if you're not speaking. I'll be speaking for like one more minute. If you don't listen to my voice clearly, then get back, okay? So I'm talking about another algorithm. Everyone clear? I'm talking about another algorithm in which what we will do is we will sort the array and we'll try partially, and then we'll try to pick one element from the non-sorted part and find the correct position of that element in the sorted part. Okay, suppose we have, everyone got the, getting my voice clearly? Anyone who seems not to?
Yeah,
now it's better now.
Yes, now it's better, you can go ahead.
Okay, so I'll go ahead now. So I was saying ki we will take one element from the sorted part, so non-sorted part, and put it into the sorted part. So initially when we started, we had like, okay, no one, zero sorted part, and rest of all of them were in the non-sorted part. So we just took one element from this, the first element from this non-sorted, and kept it into the correct position. So what it became was, from this it became, okay, this is, we took two and kept it here. Now we'll take five. Okay, the moment we take five, we will put it into, and the correct position is this. Okay, this is what it becomes. Now we take four. When we take four, we find the correct position is this 4. Sorry, the correct position is 4. Now we take 10. The correct position is 10. Now we take 7. The correct position is this. Okay. So, and at end, what we have is our sorted part, sorted array. So, what we are doing is, and this is called insertion sort. I think, why, do you understand why the name is insertion sort? We are trying to insert into an already sorted part. We are trying to insert one element from the unsorted part and put it into putting that into the sorted array. Okay. So, what we are doing is we have our input array A and we have our output array B. Something like this we have. Okay. So what we are doing is we are trying to create our B one by one by taking one element from A one by one. Okay. So what we do is we just take 2 and insert into our array A. We take 5, insert it into our array B. Now, sorry. So we take one by one each element and just insert into the output element one by one. Now, by doing this, what is happening is, so, okay, let me ask you only, what will the time complexity be of this thing? Of this approach, what will the time complexity be of this insertion sort? If you get the algorithm, if you get what I'm trying to do. Take one element one by one, take element, and then keep it inserting into the sorted array, so sorted part.
This will be also n square.
This will also be n square. Okay.
Yes, n square.
Okay. Everyone understand why would this be n square?
Because two loops are used.
Yes. So one loop we are iterating over the array A and second loop, what is the second loop we are doing?
We are finding a correct place and inserting.
Yes, almost correct. We are finding the correct position. How do we find the correct position? We have to go through each and every element and check if it is less or okay. So that finding the correct place will take how much time?
N.
Okay, so suppose I'm telling you, suppose our sorted part is of size k, it will take k time. The sorted part is k, it will take k time. So for the first time, it will take only one time. For the first loop, it will take only one time. For the second element, it will take 2 times. For the third element, it will take 3 times. For the fourth element, it will take 4 times. So the total time complexity would be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus till n, which is n plus 1 by 2, which is n square. Okay. So if you go deeper, you can try to think how much time complexity is. So what we do is we take one by one element from our unsorted array and we try to insert it into the sorted array. Now the sorted array keeps on growing. The first time it took only one time to find the correct position. Second time it took 2 times to find the correct position. Third time it took 3 times to find the correct position. And by doing this, we have our time complexity of 1 plus 2 plus 3 till n, which is equal to n plus 1 by 2. Okay. So we still missed one thing. Although the answer is correct, it is n square. You missed one thing. Finding the correct position was not the only thing. You had to find the correct position and insert into that position. Now inserting into an array at ith index is not easy. You have to insert and shift all the elements. So the time complexity would be not just insertion time, finding the time, but also inserting time. So although it won't change, but I'm just saying you should be aware you were not just finding but also inserting. Okay, so what will the complexity be? How will we calculate now? Is for the first time it will take one time to find and one time to insert. For the when the size is k, you'll find the correct position in k time and you'll need k more time to insert. How do you insert? Insert and shift all the numbers one by one to right. The shifting will take order of k. Okay, so it will be 2k. So it will be like the sum will be 2 plus 4 plus 6 plus 8 plus 10. Okay. So this is equal to 2 into n plus 1 by 2. At the end, it is n square only. So because we don't care about those constants, that's why it didn't matter. But suppose it was not constant, it would have been mattered. Okay. So you should be clear about what you're doing. So what you did was you take one element from A and we try to insert into the sorted part. The sorted part keeps on growing. Hence, the time keeps on changing. So the first element it took one time, for the second element took two time, and similarly took as k time and n time. So the final commutative work. Yes.
Praveen, I just got disconnected for a while. Can you just explain the insertion part?
Yes. So what I am doing is I am trying to take one element from A and trying to find the correct position of that element into sorted array, which is our B, the sorted part. And then we'll iterate through the sorted array one by one. We know that is already sorted. So we'll just go through that sorted part one by one for what is the current position for two, what is the current position. So let me start. Suppose we have already done for 2, 5, 4. Okay, we have already done till this. We done for now we take 10. We want to find where will 10 go. So we'll just compare with one by one. Comparing will take okay, 10, 2. So this should go after 2. 10, 4, it should go after 4. 10, 5, it should go after 10, after 5. So now after we know this will go here, we inserted 10 here. We inserted 10 here and we had to shift something. Suppose the input was this. Okay. Suppose we were this case, we have sorted till here. Now we are trying to insert 10. Okay. In this case, we would find 10 should go here. 10 should go here. Someone reconnected. Someone went away. Who came this right? Anyway.
I Nikhil. I had come back.
Okay. So yeah. Again, you lost. Where? Shall I start again?
I come back a while. I am fine.
Okay. I'll just do it for the last time. So I will do it for last time. So we have sorted till four elements. We have our sorted part 2, 5, 50, 2, 4, 5, 11. And now we want to put 10 into the correct place. And how are we doing? We're comparing with one by one with all the elements. And at the end, I know this 10 should go here. The moment I inserted 10 here, I had to shift 11. So I had to shift rest of the elements. So the shifting will take order of some time. Okay. Let's think a generic case. Suppose this was of size k. If this was size k, we'll take order of k to find the correct position, and then we'll take another order of k to shift the remaining. I mean, it won't be k, but it will be some k minus some 10, something like. But it will be in the range of k. It will not. So it will take order of 2k. At the end, it will be order of k. So I just told this that day. I'll repeat the same thing once today also. To find time complexity, first of all, we'll try to count the loop exactly. But at the end, what matters is the range. I mean, the order and not the exact value. So I'll just write some examples. Order of n, order of 2n is equals to order of n. So what it means, order of some constant kn is equal to order of n. Okay. We don't have to tell order of kn. If it is 2n, 3n, 4n, we can directly tell it is order of n. Okay. Similarly, order of n square, which is n into n, by 2. Suppose n square by 2. This is, again, this is not, we won't call it order of n square. We'll simply tell it n square. Okay. Now, suppose one more example we'll take. Order of n square. Order of n square plus order of n. Suppose this is some algorithm take this much time. Okay. Suppose some algorithm take this much time. What will the answer be? It won't be n square plus n. It will be simply order of n square. Because this n compared to n square is nothing. Okay. This is the bottleneck. If this takes order of n square, then this, we don't care about this. We only care about the maximum time taking part. Okay. The rest part, which is taking less than that, is of no use. This, so if you suppose we are sorting million numbers, then doing some million into million will be nothing compared to million into million. That's why we don't care about the smaller part. Everyone with me? Because my hello, is there everyone with me?
Yes, probably.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. This is one example. Let's take more examples. Order of n log n. Order of n log n. Arjun? Hello, Arjun, can you hear me? So order of n log n plus order of n square. Can someone tell me what will this be?
Order of n square.
N square.
Okay. So n log n into log n is less than n square. So we don't care about the n log n part. We only care about this bigger part. Okay. Now, so you should be aware, like one is, this is normally we get about, get to listen fine. Okay, normally these kind of values you'll get in terms of one constant time, log n time, n square time, n cube time, and exponential time. Okay, most of the problems will be of these range only. Okay, we'll always be converting into these, whether it will take n time, n square time, n cube time, or exponential time, or log n time. Okay, so and this is the order, all of you know, log n is less than n and n square is more than, we all know this. Okay, you just should be aware of this, and I have written it for your help. You can take this key. Whenever you calculate, log n is will be less than n, so how to get the final answer. Now coming back to our insertion sort. Yeah, so insertion sort was taking, I was doing insertion into this already sorted part. We were inserting 10 in the already sorted 2 4 5 11, so we had to insert this here. This took another k time, so the total time of insertion sort is 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 6 plus 8 plus till 2n, which is equal to n, twice of n plus 1 by 2, which is equal to n into n minus 1, which is equal to n square minus n, which is equal to n. Let me just write what I just said. So you should be able to do this in mind. You don't have to even speak of this. How did it come up? This is the total time complexity, which is equal to 2 into 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, which is equal to 2 into n minus 1 by 2, which is equal to n into n minus 1, which is equal to n square minus n, which is equal to n square. And then we have this. Okay, so our insertion sort will also be n square. Are we, did we didn't, we were looking for something better than n square, but we are still stuck with n square. So bubble sort, n square, insertion sort, n square. Can someone think of something better? Anyone, do you have any better than n square? We are done with two n squares. One is insertion sort and one is bubble sort. Anything else? Yes.
What about the quick sort?
Okay, so now we are talking about the quick sort. There is a very famous algorithm. So now before I tell about this, you can whenever you're solving anything, if that solution includes sorting, you can assume order n log n. We'll just talk about how did we calculate this n log n and which is that algorithm. But there is something called quick sort, whose time complexity when we talk about is order of n log n. So you can use this as thumb rule anywhere. Whenever your solution includes, I will sort and do this. Just assume n log n. You can easily assume. No one, no interview will say, why, how come? I mean, they might ask you to check your basic knowledge, but you can easily assume whenever it's solving any question, if that includes sorting, you'll just, okay, I'll do sorting, which will take order of n log n, and then I'll do this, which will take more time. So and final, this is the final time complexity is. So now coming to the quick sort. What is quick sort? How do you do quick sort? And what will the time complexity be? That will be the last thing we'll teach today. And then we'll have to stop, okay? So let's try to talk about the quick sort now. So what quick sort is, we will try to divide this. Okay, so there's a question by Santosh. What is the difference between n log n and n log n? So order of So log of n is this. I mean, log of n is this. This is log of n. So suppose n equal to n equal to 1000, and let's assume we are doing with base. You understand these logs and base, and write it here. So what is log n? Log n is with base 10. What is log of 1000? Anyone? What is log of 1000 with base 10? What is log of 1000? And whoever is making
three
yourself. Okay, 3. Log of 1000 is 3. Given basis, I mean, you must have read about this 10 to the power 3 and all those things. 10 to the power 3. Base 10 I'm writing here. So log of 10 to the power 3 is 3. Okay, and what is the question? Was what is n log n? N log n is n into log of n. This is nothing but n into. So n into means 1000 into.
Can you show how you come, how we come to a solution where we get log n as this?
Yes, let's try to talk about a question. Find min. Oh no, wait. Find min. So any binary algorithm, binary thing we do is find element in a sorted array. Find an element in a sorted array. Okay. So the question is, there is a sorted array 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 1,010, something like that, and you have to find 8. 8 is present or not. Okay. There is a sorted array. You have to find if 8 is present or not. How will you do it?
We can check by like in the sorted array, just like the middle element, and check whether that element lies whether left side or right side. Based on that, we can search it out. It is like a binary search something.
Okay. So what he is saying is he will do binary search. Before we come to the binary search, what we'll do is let's just think that trivial approach again. We will just try to find the element one by one. We compare. Is A 0 equal to n? No. A 1 equal to n? No. A 2 equal to n? No. A 3 equal to n? Yes. We got it. Otherwise, we'll reach the end of the array and we'll not find it. That will be the most trivial and the brute force approach. And how much time that will take?
O of n.
Okay. Order of n. Now, can we be a little smarter? Yes. We know the array is sorted. So we don't have to necessarily check each and every event. We'll just try to jump into the middle and we'll compare. Is it equal to what I'm trying to find? Is A of mid, is A of mid element, and mid index equal to what a number I am finding? If yes, we got it. Otherwise,
Praveen, can I interrupt here? I have some other work. It's almost 1:30 a.m. midnight.
So yes, sure.
Can we? Can I disconnect, or are you going to end up this call?
No, you can disconnect yourself. We'll go on, and we'll also be done in like 10 minutes. Okay, you can go. You can disconnect.
Okay. Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So what we're doing is we are trying to find the middle element in a sorted array. What we have to do is we jump to the middle element, and the moment we check whether it is what we're trying to find. Yes or no. If it is a yes, awesome, we got an element. Otherwise, we will not search in both the array. We know this number, we can compare. Is it bigger than the middle element or less than middle element? If it is bigger than the middle element, this means our element will be present in the second half, in the right side of the middle element and not on the left. Since suppose the array is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, something like this, and we are trying to find 5. What we are doing is we jumped into the okay. We are trying to find 8. Okay, we are trying to find 8. We jumped in the middle, and middle element was 5. So we told okay, 5 is a middle element. and 5 is not equal to 8, but 8 is bigger. So this means we have to search in the just give me a second. Yeah, so this means we have to search into the right array. I mean, we don't have to go into the left array anymore. So this one, this if n is equal to mid is equal to sorted array, okay, so can you see this? Yeah, okay, so what we're doing here is, we took the middle index and we compared, is it less than middle index, a middle index value? Yes, it is less, then try to do recursively in the left part of the array from start till mid minus one. This is left of the array, okay? Same array, we'll do from start till mid minus one. If it is more than middle element, then do the same thing in the from mid plus one till end. Okay, so I'm calling it recursively, but in this time I'm changing the index. Do the same thing from mid plus one to end. Otherwise, just return true. Okay. Now this approach, the earlier approach took order of n, but this approach will. What will the time complexity be? Anyone? What will the time complexity be of this case, of this solution? Anyone?
Log in.
N log
in. Yeah, someone. Anyone just tell me and we'll go ahead.
N log in.
N log in.
Yes, yes. So wait, the complexity will be log of n. How? If someone didn't get how, is how much time did we take to find this? So for the first loop, for the first cycle, it will go jump into the middle element. Okay, but every time we are breaking our array into two subarray, but we are only worried about one array, and we are ignoring the second array. So the first size will be n, and then size will be n by 2. Okay, and then size will be n by 4, in which we'll find, and then finally, the worst case, we'll end up at a time when the size will be equal to 1, and we know, okay, by doing this, n by 1, n by 8, okay, so this is the number of times, okay, we're reducing the size of the array. Our size of the array is, earlier it started with n, and then it became n by 2, and then it became n by 4, and then it became n by 8, and at the last it became 1, okay, now, how many times we'll do this? What is the count? This is the size of the array. We don't have to add this. What I'm saying is, every time we are reducing the problem size from n to n by 2 till it becomes 1. So how many times we have to do this? This count is equal to log of n. Again, this is from mathematics. This is equal to log of n. So that's what. In this case, that complexity is equal to log of n. We reduce the problem to half of the original size, and by the end we are left with our solution, I mean single element, and we know, okay, this is either this element is equal to what we are looking for, or it is gone. Okay, so we are ignoring this rest of the array. Only half array is we are solving for every time. Got it? How you became log of n? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So we won't be doing quicksort today. We'll do it in next class, and that is a little bit complex as well. So I don't want to give you a lot of stress over right now. So it's 11 o'clock now. We'll have to end here. So next class we'll start with array. Okay. Today what we mostly learned about is how to find time complexity, how to find space complexity, and what these things are, the general terminologies, and few, how to like check whether the loops are there or not, if how to analyze the loops, how to write recursion. Also we found that how to write recursion, how to think about base cases or the terminating cases, how to convert a solution from a recursion to a dynamic program, a little bit we looked over that. So next class I won't be, these are the basic which will be required every time. Next class will start with array, okay? Like storing into array and using array for multiple places in few questions. Like how can these array be useful in which kind of questions? There will be many questions based on array. Okay, you have been given an array of this, do this. Sort the elements, or sometimes it will merge arrays, or sometimes it will be reverse the element. Sometimes we find an element, those kind of things are there. We can do a lot of things into array. The array is the most primitive data type data store we use. This is one of the mostly used and simplest data structure, array. And then there are more complicated but more efficient data structures like linked list, tree, hash maps, heaps, graphs. So there are more complicated, more efficient for more different use cases. We'll go through one by one each of them. Next class will be dedicated for arrays. We'll learn a little bit about arrays, some operations in like first 15 minutes. Then we'll take lots of questions on array. Okay. Anything you want to ask today more? Anything else?
Any assignment from today's class?
You should be writing at least one code which we discuss, and one of them would be. Yeah. So let's go ahead and write the code for Fibonacci of n. Using the dynamic programming, okay, without the iteration. Let's not use the word dynamic programming, but yes.
Regarding space complexity, so it just means that when you are adding, like in DP, we are adding an extra array to store. So yes. In that case, that just means that since you are adding for n elements, so the space mm-hmm. complexity is increasing by n. Is it right?
I mean, the word is the space complexity is n. No, it's not saying increasing by n. So what we're doing is we are initializing our a equal to an array a of size n. That's it. The moment we initialize, we use extra space. So we are using an extra variable extra store to store out in some data. So some solution which I guess. Let's take the last example. We do not use anything. The last example, if we just talk about finding the element, okay, this we didn't use any extra space. Just single constant mid was enough. Okay, mid was enough for us to solve this. But suppose we had stored 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4 somewhere else or as well, just for some purpose. In that case, that extra space means we are using some extra space to solve our question. In that case, the space complexity would have been order of n. Okay.
Okay.
By the way, just for knowledge, this the final element which we did is called binary search. Okay, binary search. We took a binary decision. This is one of the famous term. What is binary search? Finding an element into a sorted array using the algorithm called binary search will take time complexity of that binary search is log of n. You can, as I told you, suppose your big solution involves the small solution of okay, I will do a binary search, find the number. You can straightforward use it. Binary search will take log n, so total will be this much. Okay, something like that. You can always use the binary search will take log n anywhere. This is one of the most very popular algorithm which you don't have to explain necessarily how they won't ask you. Okay, tell me how they won't ask you. They'll assume. Interview will assume. Yeah, that's okay. So my solution will do binary search, and that binary search takes log n, so this will take k log n. You can easily say, okay. So yeah, that's it. So again, if any one of you have anything, otherwise we'll end the class. And the assignment is find the Fibonacci of n without iteration. Okay, which was like dynamic programming solution which I gave. Try to use, complete this for sure. I would, my email ID, you can note down. I can type also. So send me a solution as soon as you, or let me start a thread, email thread. I'll add all of you, but I need to have email of every one of you. So just give me a second. Yes. Every one of you can leave me your email or drop me an email at this email ID. Or ask me some question at this email ID. I'll get back. Also, I'm sending my email, phone number. You can ping me on WhatsApp. I might reply late, but I'll reply for sure. Okay. So yeah, if you have any question, talk to my email, phone number, or when you have solved this, just drop the solution on this email ID. Okay. Try to complete. We'll have tomorrow. We have one more class. So I would expect you do it before tomorrow. Better for you. We might not be like, I might not be asking, but you should be solving on your own because that will help a lot. Okay. Anything else? Shall I end the meeting?
Yeah.
Okay. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.